Welcome to Living Waters. Thank you. We're actually going to start with a video that our youth put together for the chili cook-off. So, here we go.
Welcome to our 2023 annual chili cook-off here at Barney Waters. Here we have two contestants right here, and let's try some chili. All right, first chili. That sucks.
How could you say it sucks? It's my great-great-grandma's recipe.
It tastes like a great-great-grandma.
No.
All right, this better be better. That tastes worse than the first one.
What? My second cousin first removed died making that for me 72 years ago.
Is that why it tastes so bad? How'd you get in here?
Get mine.
How'd you get in here?
Sorry, I was late.
Well, what's in this?
I put some corn in there, some other meat that you wouldn't want to know.
Like this tastes fantastic! Well, I think we have our winner here of our annual 2023 chili cook-off.
Oh, thank you.
St. Barnabas and Living Waters Youth Group welcomes you to St. Barnabas for the chili cook-off on February 25th, 5 to 7 p.m.
Tickets for adults are $10, kids $5, and anyone under 3, it's free.
Come prepared to buy tickets and participate in the wine pool.
Thank you for supporting our youth group for our summer mission trip to Milwaukee.
Enjoy your chili, and thank you for support.
And if you turn around and look at the table, there's Sydney and Jonah. Giveaway. No, come on. I told you wouldn't have to speak today. I told you not to speak today. That's a good deal. There they are. Hey, all right. Yeah. They will be selling tickets at that table after service for the chili cook-off. And thank you for your support. This helps the youth go on the mission trip to Milwaukee. I'm now going to turn it over to Jenny Conway, who has a temple talk for us this morning.
Good morning. I'm Jenny Conway. I'm a former member of the church council as of last week. I've served a couple times, and thank you very much for everybody, your connections. What, Pastor? That's because I have new avenues. So I am doing the stewardship talk. And I have to say, I'm Jenny, and I'm married to John Conway, and we have had quite a journey here at Living Waters and had many different ventures that we have done. Now, to help me, so I don't have go on this very long rant about, not a rant, but long explanation of our of our participation at Living Waters, I'll structure it up to the gift inventory that Heidi had shared with us through stewardship. She's also shared it in the past too at women's retreats. And as part of a follow-up from the women's retreat, she sent out a resource from the Women of ELCA. And it has some descriptions of what these spiritual gifts are. And I'm like, that's me, you know? So I went through and I'm a school social worker, so in the teaching field, we have all kinds of measurements, you know, to make sure kids pass tests and stuff. I got 100% in a couple areas, you know, I got like probably about 95% here. There are some that I'm about 50% at, so I'm going to speak to the ones that are stronger gifts for me. So as far as my bigger areas, I did have the gift of mercy. Kind of matches up with a school social work kind of thing. And so it's the gift of mercy is the act of feeling deeply for those that are in physical, spiritual, and emotional need and being able to act on those needs. So I'm like, yep, that's me. And so part of my job at school is that we work with a variety of different families, a variety of different economic categories, a variety of cultural categories. And I have found that one of my key things that I do in the schools is help my teachers to understand where the families are coming from. Because it's like, why didn't the parent turn in that permission slip? Why aren't they returning my call? Why? And you can become really frustrated with a family because you don't understand. And so we have found that some of our families, you know, the moms are working two jobs and so is dad. And then, you know, there's like a lot of different factors that are going on that we don't see on the outside. And so that has brought me to where I'm at right now. So I love people and love being around people and just getting to know them. In the schools, I have children who have needs, and that's because of maybe a birth defect, sick, maybe, we don't know, you know, learning disabilities, autism, just a variety of needs. And so it's hard for them to express themselves. And I have the preschoolers, so they're really young and trying to share. And so with that, trying to understand when you see a child who looks the same as the other kids on the outside, but they just like have this emotional outburst, and it's like, what's going on with them? They just need to pull it together kind of thing. Well, there are some differences in people, and we learn to work with those differences. And so that is a part of my job. And so I've been able to work with Sunday school, starting out when I was like a high school kid, and vacation Bible school, and which led to me to be a vacation Bible school leader here, thanks to one of my kids, Britton, who is a vacation Bible school junkie. And so we did have some years that it was, the question was, who's going to lead this? A little background on my family is I have two kids. Emily is my first, and I knew for sure, like when I was pregnant with Emily, that I was having a boy. And so when the doctor said it's a girl, I was like, what? And I don't know where the idea that I was having a boy came out. But it was from probably, like, I had two older nephews, and I was like, just kind of like in the boy mind. And so when I was pregnant with Brynn, I knew for sure that I was going to have a boy because it was a totally different pregnancy. And so Brynn's not a boy either. So there are some things that I don't understand from the inside and out. But recently we learned from Brynn that Brynn is not necessarily a girl either, you know, because Brynn is non-binary. And we've learned that people are in different kind of boxes, and, you know, that's a boy, that's a girl. And there are, in schools, scientific kind of data backgrounds that we have to check. And so God has brought me here to work on the RIC committee. And so a lot of focus is going on there. We just had a recent meeting, and we had some tasks to do. And I was like, I can't do it. I have so much to do. But now I'm not on council, so it does give me more time. And so God makes pathways for us to be able to do these different things. When Emily was a teenager, I was not able to go on mission trips with Emily. And so I'm telling you this because you guys have spiritual gifts that you have. So I have the gift of bigger ones as the mercy giving is another one where I've served on a gazillion committees here, whether they're short-term committees or like working on church council for years on, you know, they get expanded from like a two-year commitment to a three-year commitment kind of thing. I've led outreach. I've not done stewardship. Money is not my thing. So, but now I'm doing a stewardship talk. So with that, I also have the background, another strong one is faith. So God has given me faith that there are going to be some hard times. And Pastor spoke a couple weeks ago about you have these gifts and you might say, I'm busy. So with that, yeah, we are busy. But I do make sure I take time to come up to worship on Sundays. It refreshes me. It's good for me. I make sure that I go to Karen's, it's called ABS now. No, it's Adult Bible Study. It used to be Adult Forum, but I get refreshed. I get new information, and it enriches me so that I can go out and have a better understanding of what's going on. So with that, with the faith and with the giving, I have learned that I have to sometimes say, okay, I'm not going to do this, and God is going to make a way for us. So I was so lucky when Bryn was in high school because I was able to go on the mission trips. Emily didn't happen, but God made a way for somebody else to go on mission trips with Emily. And Bryn was fine with me going on mission trips, thank goodness, because some kids are like, I'm not going. So in the school setting, I do have the ability to work on vacation Bible school things because I have the summers free. I can help with like the mission trips because I have that time free. I think I've covered a lot of information. Overall, I think that, just to let you know, I'm going to continue to work on the RAC committee because I want to help people feel welcoming and heard and understood. And so I think that's probably it for now. I think I talked your ear off. So I do invite you guys to go ahead and take the spiritual gift inventory. There are a lot of areas that you can serve on short-term or long-term, and you might find one that you're like, it's me. Do I have time? Maybe not. Can you make time? Yeah, you can make time. So thank you very much.
Thank you, Jenny. And if you need help finding that spiritual gift inventory, let me know. Very good. All right. I see I might have some other announcements over here. Come on up. Who's first?
I had to write the dates down so I didn't mess it up. Save the date. It is February, and we have coming up on Tuesday, February 21st, our traditional Mardi Gras Fat Tuesday. So that will be Tuesday, February 21st, here at the church. It'll be a potluck, as always. We'll have fun activities and things for the kids, families. And then Fellowship will provide pancakes. So bring all your favorite sweets, carbs, and comfort foods, and we will have a good potluck.
What time?
I'm thinking 7 p.m.
Okay.
Yeah.
All right. Thank you, Rachel. Always down to eat comfort food. Heidi?
Good morning. I have two announcements. Let's see which one. Well, this is in front of me. So Vision Summit is on the 26th. We're asking people to RSVP for it. You remember maybe doing a survey or hearing about the surveys. You don't need to have done a survey to come to the summit. Please come. We are serving food. We're serving good food, so come. And so I'll have this in the back for you to snap, or you'll also be able to register online. I think it'll come out sometime this week during the one of Carol's emails I've asked. The second announcement is starting next week, we're going to have our hanging basket sale supporting the youth. And for the first time ever, we're going to have delivery on Mother's Day. So you're welcome. Ooh. For giving you your Mother's Day gifts. Baskets are $27 and gift cards are $25 this year. And the youth will be selling those starting next week. I think there will be a link also online this week as well.
True, yes.
Oh, Kermit already Look saw my, my email question.
Look at that. Teamwork.
We're all working together here. Thank you.
All right. Thank you, Heidi. Excellent. Come on, we could have given them a little ooh. Like, come on. It's sunny out. Wake up. Wake up. Come on. All right. All right. Finally, if you have not voted, we've had a lot of votes, but just in case, logo votes are going to be closing tomorrow, so if you haven't voted, please do. Kermit, do you want to talk about giving statements, or are we good?
Only if you want a printed one, let me know, and I can get it to you. So.
All right. I did want to lift up, there's an anniversary I got wind of. Bob and Joan Chauncey are celebrating their 65th anniversary this week. Yeah. Years, so congratulations. That's wonderful. All right. That's it. Unless anybody else has anything else. Okay. Well, then please stand as you're able as we begin worship together with our confession and forgiveness. Blessed be the Holy Trinity, one God, who makes all things new, whose mercy endures forever. Amen. Trusting in God's mercy, let us confess our sin together. Holy One, source of renewal, we confess that we are wrapped up in sin and cannot free ourselves. We have not practiced your righteousness. Our hearts have turned away from you. For the sake of the world you so love, forgive us, that we may be reconciled to one another for the glory of your holy name. Amen. Thus says our God, the former things have come to pass, and the new things I now declare. God's mercy makes us new. We are forgiven in the name of Christ our Savior. Amen. God, with endless mercy, you receive the prayers of all who call upon you. By your Spirit, show us the things we ought to do. Give us the grace and power to do them. Through Jesus Christ, our Savior and Lord. Amen. Please be seated.
The first reading this morning is from Isaiah, chapter 58, verses 1 through 2. I have 1 through 12. I have 12 verses. Do you know which one it is? 1 through 12. Okay. Isaiah 58, verses 1 through 12. And if you're following along on in your Bible, or the Bible under the chair in front of you, you'll find it starting on page 600. Isaiah 58, beginning at the first verse. Shout out, do not hold back. Lift up your voice like a trumpet. Announce to my people their rebellion, to the house of Jacob their sins. Yet day after day they seek me and delight to know my ways, as if they were a nation that practiced righteousness and did not forsake the ordinance of their God. They ask of me righteous judgments. They delight to draw near to God. Why do we fast, but you do not see? Why humble ourselves, but you do not notice? Look, You serve your own interest on your fast day and oppress all your workers. Look, you fast only to quarrel and fight and to strike with a wicked fist. Such fasting as you do today will not make your voice heard on high. Is not the fast that I choose a day to humble oneself? Is it to bow down the head like a bulrush and to lie in sackcloth and ashes? Will you call this a fast, a day acceptable to the Lord? Is not this the fast that I choose, to loose the bonds of injustice, to undo the thongs of the yoke, to let the oppressed go free and to break every yoke? Is it not to share your bread with the hungry and bring the homeless poor into your home? When you see the naked, to cover them and not to hide yourself from your own kin. Then your light shall break forth like the dawn and your healing shall spring up quickly. Your vindicator shall go before you. The glory of the Lord shall be your rear guard. Then you shall call and the Lord will answer. You shall cry for help and he will say, "Here I am." If you remove the yoke from among you, the pointing of the finger, the speaking of evil, if you offer your food to the hungry and satisfy the needs of the afflicted, then your light shall rise in the darkness and your gloom be like the noonday. The Lord will guide you continually and satisfy your needs in parched places and make your bones strong. And you shall be like a watered garden, like a spring of water, whose waters never fail. Your ancient ruins shall be rebuilt. You shall raise up the foundations of many generations. You shall be called the repairer of the breach, the restorer of streets to live in. Our second reading today is from 1 Corinthians chapter 2, verses 1 through 12. And if you're following along in the Bible, it's on page 927. 1 Corinthians chapter 2, beginning at the first verse. When I came to you, brothers and sisters, I did not come proclaiming the mystery of God to you in lofty words of wisdom, for I decided to know nothing among you except Jesus Christ and him crucified. And I came to you in weakness and in fear and in much trembling. My speech and proclamation were not with plausible words of wisdom, but with a demonstration of the Spirit and of power, so that your faith might rest not on human wisdom, but on the power of God. Yet among the mature we do speak wisdom, though it is not a wisdom of this age or of the rulers of this age who are doomed to perish. But we speak God's wisdom, secret and hidden, which God decreed before the ages for our glory. None of the rulers of this age understand this, for if they had, they would not have crucified the Lord of glory. But as it is written, what no eye has seen, nor ear heard, nor the human heart conceived, what God has prepared for those who love him. These things God has revealed to us through the Spirit, for the Spirit searches everything, even the depths of God. For what human being knows what is truly human, except the human spirit that is within? So also, no one comprehends what is truly God's, except the Spirit of God. Now we have received not the spirit of the world, but the Spirit that is from God, so that we may understand the gifts bestowed on us by God. Word of God, word of life.
Please stand as you are able for the reading of the gospel. The Holy Gospel of our Lord according to Matthew, the fifth chapter. This is Matthew 5, 13 through 20. You can find this on page 786. If you had left it open from last week, it's the same page. I told you to be here for a while. Okay, anyway. And guess what? Keep it there. Matthew 5, 13 through 20. Jesus said, "You are the salt of the earth. But if salt has lost its taste, how can its saltiness be restored? It is no longer good for anything, but is thrown out and trampled underfoot. You are the light of the world. A city built on a hill cannot be hid. No one, after lighting a lamp, puts it under a bushel basket, but on the lampstand, and it gives light to the whole house. In the same way, let your light shine before others, so that they may see your good works and give glory to your Father in heaven. Do not think that I've come to abolish the law of the prophets. I have come not to abolish, but to fulfill. For truly I tell you, until heaven and earth pass away, not one letter, not one stroke of a letter, will pass from the law until all is accomplished. Therefore, whoever breaks one of the least of these commandments and teaches others to do the same will be called least in the kingdom of heaven. But whoever does them and teaches them will be called great in the kingdom of heaven. For I tell you, unless your righteousness exceeds that of the scribes and the Pharisees, you will never enter the kingdom of heaven. This is the gospel of our Lord. Please be seated and invite the kids up for the children's message this morning. Good morning. How you doing?
Good.
Yeah? Okay. So, thankfully, we are getting this bright sun and the snow is melting. It is wonderful. I hope the groundhog's wrong, okay? Stupid rodent. Anyway, and all part of God's creation, though. Have you ever put salt down on a sidewalk? A slipper of the driveway, yeah. Okay, so imagine me. This is the closest thing I get to my. I was gonna bring the real scoop in, but it was really gross. So we're gonna use this. Pretend it's a scoop, okay? So I got my salt, and I'm sprinkling around. Right here I am. So we're picturing this, okay? It's a cold February day. I'm out here sprinkling salt as the ice kind of built up. Okay, delivery person comes right from Amazon. Okay, and wait, I shouldn't say who they're from. They're not sponsoring the sermon. Anyway, from a company not to be named. And they said, hey, thank you for salting the sidewalk. Which I was like, you're welcome, right? He said that a lot of folks don't do that, and it's pretty slick, okay? I was doing it for Rex, but I let him believe it was for him. So it reminded me, though, we have this text, right, that we're the salt of the earth. Salt has a lot of uses, we'll hear in a moment, okay? That includes giving us a grip. Right? Sometimes our faith life can be like that. That sometimes we need that saltiness, that simple yet effective thing that helps us get a grip in the messy slush and ice of life. Okay. All right. Will you pray with me this morning? I invite the congregation to join in as well. Dear God,
we thank you
for your Son, Jesus Christ.
Please help us
to share your word. And our faith, and scatter it like salt. In your name we pray. Amen. All right, thanks for coming up this morning. Have a great week. All right, so like I said, I told you we were staying in Matthew chapter 5, the Sermon on the Mount, for a little while. I have to ask, 1 week in, how has your sticky notes changes gone so far? Okay, we got a mix. Okay, all right. Well, good news, the Sermon on the Mount isn't over. Jesus has more guidance for us in our new changes for the year ahead. And get ready for this one. Because in growing in our lives of faith, God teaches us, Christians, to be salty. Wait, that didn't come out right, did it? Wait a minute. Maybe not as we use it, right? We're not meant to be bitter, but rather effective. As you may remember from years ago, like how sriracha enhances the flavor of a dish, a little callback there. But friends, I found now even that understanding of this passage is rudimentary. I've grown in the 3 years since, too. For there are plenty of outside-the-box ways that salt makes its saltiness effective in the world. We talked about one in the kids' sermon moments ago. But to help show what I mean, I turn to another, quite lesser guidance in my life, the Food Network, okay? A few weeks ago, they published an article that caught my eye because I knew our little salt talk here was coming up. It's called 9 Clever Ways to Use Salt. So I stashed it away. I stashed it away for this morning, okay? See, saltiness is more than just sprinkling in a little flavor. Salt has many uses. The first that the Food Network gives us to make an everyday salt brine. Apparently, salt brines, this was news to me, are used to render meats, to make them more tender and juicy without being more salty. I really hope you ate before service today, by the way. There's snacks in the back if you get hungry. Over time, the salt breaks down the meat's proteins in order for this to work. Which got me thinking, as Christians and our witness, we need to be persistent too. We're called to break down injustice and evil in the world. Being salty isn't just spicing something up. It could be a gentle persistence that truly creates positive change. Number 2 and 3 go together. Apparently, also news to me, salt can be used to remove stains. If you're like me and you spill a lot when eating, this was good news. This was good news. It can remove stains from your clothing. Can also help scrub, you know, like those the baking dish in the corner where all the stuff gets stuck. Put some salt in there. Yeah, put some salt in there because apparently it helps observe stubborn oils to be able to clean it. Okay, again, Christians, not just spicing things up. We can get into the tough spots in the world that no one else wants to go to, the spots that perhaps get missed sometimes. When we answer calls from God that are uniquely suited for us, we're salty. Okay? All right, number four, and number five together. Number four is enhancing sweets. Awesome. Number five is a salt crush for fish. Not as awesome, but healthier. Both center on this idea, though, that salt can lift up other flavors without adding salt to the palate. Salt doesn't have to be the star. Salt can support from the sidelines. And I want to make clear, as Christians, your calling in your life, it doesn't always have to be in the spotlight. You don't always have to be front and center. You can make a difference in your faith by supporting others around you, just like that salt. The next clever use is to tame sour flavors. Tame sour flavors. Heartburn people. Take that down, okay? I'm with you. We talk about that we are gifted people. We heard this morning in the temple talk, in fact. We are given many blessings. So use them. Be salty. Cancel out some of the sourness in the world. Help protect others. Stand up for those that can't speak for themselves. Again, the next two as a pair. Apparently, they can be used to clean cutting boards, leaving them smelling fresh. Salt is apparently also the best thing to put out a grease fire. Yes. Sometimes being salty is hardcore sometimes, okay? Sacrificial love, we talked about last week, is at the heart of the Beatitudes and the very witness of Jesus Christ. When the church is salty, when we are marked by sacrificing for the sake of others, we're living that out. We sacrifice so others may be refreshed. We put ourselves on the fires. We lay down our lives for the sake of love. Finally, make an oyster bed. I always thought that was ice. Apparently, that is salt that the oysters are on. Did you know that? I had no idea. Because apparently, salt, it melts and it can fall over, but the salt, it perfectly forms around those shells. So none of that delicious, salty, natural, briny juices in there fall out and the oysters would lose its flavor. Sometimes being salty is built on being flexible to what our community needs, of meeting what those needs are. Being salty can even look like inviting others into our community of faith, making them feel welcome no matter how unique they are. Okay, and finally, number 10, I had to add a bonus one. If you have a cold beverage and it's sweating, you know, hot days are coming again, I swear, and the glass is sticking to the coaster or the napkin, put a little salt in between and it'll no longer stick, okay? Good tip. I don't really have anything to connect that cleverly to faith, but thought you would want to know, okay? I'll look it out for you. So now hearing all these clever ways of how to use salt, why does Jesus only use taste? I don't know, they don't have snow in Galilee very often, but surely Jesus knows that salts help clear roads, right? But then I realized maybe it's not Jesus that's missing something, maybe it's me that's missing something. For I took Jesus' teaching only at that first literal understanding translated into English. If salt has lost its taste, how can its saltiness be restored? As meaning that the salt's only good for adding flavor. But in the Greek, sure enough, there's more there. In the Greek, that word for losing taste, it's not that. It's rather the salt has, it's a philosophical term. It's the salt has lost its ability of what it's meant to be. The salt is about being salty in all its aspects. So the salt has lost that ability to be salty. What good is it? It's the same word, actually, we had in last week's reading. That 1 Corinthians passage, that the wise are made foolish is the word. The same word, though. As in the wise have lost their ability to have wisdom. Right? Maybe wisdomness would be the correct word. It's never translated as the foolish have become salty, is it? Okay? So clearly there's something going on here. Rather, the wise have lost their ability to have wisdom, to be inherently wise, and thus it is often translated in English as foolish. Another example is the resurrection story. When the women go to the tomb to care for Jesus' body, spoiler alert, not there. Anyway. And Luke tells us that they carry spices and often gets translated as ointment. But it's the same word again. It's better translated as an emphasis for that spice. The spices that are spicy, spicy spiciness in a cream. Maybe. It's not about taste. Salt is more about than taste. It's about something at its core of what it's meant to be as designed by God. And sure, that design, that divine design, it changes too. We are called to discern and to change and grow. We talked about this last week. Even closer to that more true selves that God has called us to be. It's also what Jesus is getting at this latter, often misapplied teaching. Jesus didn't come to abolish the law. The law is still, again, this word is still law-y. Law-y? I don't know. We're making up words now. At its core, it's meant to guide. But how that law had been expressed and understood up until this point of history, yeah, Jesus came to understand that expression for sure. God's law is still what it was always at the core, but it's been used differently. As Luther writes, the law was always meant to be about God's love, despite how it had been and has been used otherwise. Now stay with me here. Stay with me here, okay? With all of this, meaning that salt isn't about taste, I get why the English translations often salt has lost its taste, because that sounds way better than salt has lost its inherent existence of being salty. It just does. But the second one's more accurate. It misleads us to focus on one way. The saltiness is helpful in the world. Salt is so much more than taste. It's about being salty. And this perhaps small translation issue, it has big ramifications. Though how we will do ministry will change, how we express our faith will transform, the church at its core is still churchy. We cannot forget that we are part of something greater than ourselves, no matter how we change. We cannot forget we are designed to strive to meet those baptismal promises, no matter how meeting those promises may look different. We must always be focused on the sharing the grace of Christ, even if that's in different ways. This is who we are at our core, as designed by God, even if we're still figuring it out. As Christians, we're supposed to be Christian-y, or I would put, as else in Scripture, imitators of Christ. No matter how we change at our core, that's who we are to be. God loves when we figure out new ways to be our salty selves, even if it's greatly different than before. But at the same time, we're always God's beloved child. And so as we heard last week, some of the ways that we are meant to be in the Beatitudes, and we committed to making changes to better help us as who we are as Christians. Therefore, friends, as we try to live out this first part of the Sermon on the Mount, we can't forget who we are as children of God. We're salty. We're beloved. God created each one of us unique. Don't try to be something you're not. Be fully you. Whatever that is, whatever it is that God is calling you to. Though we grow, though we change, hopefully for the better, sometimes in small ways and others in huge life-altering expressions, we must never lose sight that we are God's own beloved. We must live with this understanding always that we are loved and we're always worthy of love. We have a God who loves us. No matter what we discern about ourselves, no matter how we express who we are changes, no matter how our identity is altered, at our core, you are you. And you are loved. And you're salty. Don't forget that. Don't make changes from last week based on what you think you're supposed to do or you're supposed to say. Sometimes I worry as Christians we fall into this trap of, well, the ideal Christian acts a certain way and looks a certain way and does things a certain way, but that isn't what God wants from us. There isn't an ideal disciple mold we put ourselves into, well, outside of Jesus. We're already claimed and loved by God. We don't need to fit into someone else's mold. Rather, we remember who we are, called by God, called to be salty, called to be the very thing that makes us who we are. God doesn't want you to live out your faith as someone else. God wants you to live out your faith only as you can. Maybe you're really good at lifting up others from behind the scenes. Good. Don't try to be one of the people front and center or one of the people who put out the grease fires. That's their gifts. Use yours. Hey, maybe being true to who God created and called you to be is centered on being a salty and fierce advocate. Good. We need that too. We've had others lead our efforts in gentle caring for those in need. We have those that use the saltiness to help others in their faith grow. It's the beauty of the church. We are all called. We are all different. But together we share God's grace in all of those different ways. So today, yeah, we're reclaiming salty, okay? Salt is more than just taste. We are more than what the world tells us we are. We are not afraid to be the unique and called people that God would have us be. We are proud to have a God who loves us, who calls us to more. That no matter how we change or grow, we are forever loved. So Christians, go out this week and be salty. Amen.
Son, Jesus our Savior.
Please stand as you are able. And join me in confessing our faith in the words of the Apostles' Creed. I believe in God, the Father Almighty, creator of heaven and earth. I believe in Jesus Christ, God's only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, died, and was buried. He ascended into the dead. Third day he rose again. He ascended into heaven. He is seated at the right hand of the Father. He will come to judge the living and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen. Called together to follow Jesus, we pray for the church, the world, and all in need. Call your people to seek your wisdom in difficult conversations and actions. Give the church everywhere courage to repent from the ways we have tolerated and practiced injustice. Merciful God, inspire our wonder at creation. From the light of dawn to the beauty of the dark night, sustain the unseen depths of the ocean to the plants and animals we know well. Bring healing to lands and communities experiencing natural disasters. Merciful God, instruct the powerful in your ways. Provide upright leadership in business and industry, that workers are not oppressed. Throughout the world, inspire voters and raise up politicians to heed your call for nations to practice righteousness. Merciful God, loosen the bonds of injustice in our midst. Grant peace to endless quarrels. Put an end to hunger and break every yoke of oppression. Shelter all who flee abuse in their homes or violence in their communities. Satisfy those afflicted in any way. This time we lift up prayers out loud in the silence of our hearts or at home in the comments section. Merciful God, shape our congregation to be salt for the earth. Give us delight in your commandments, that we are generous with those in need. Make us steadfast in our trust in you, ready with tangible mercy and compassion for our neighbors. Merciful God, the cross and resurrection bring redemption from sin and death. We praise you for all whose unshaken faith in Christ shines forth in their witness. Keep them in our remembrance and bring us with them into the kingdom of heaven. Merciful God, we bring to you our needs and hopes, O God, trusting your wisdom and power revealed in Christ crucified. Amen. The peace of Christ be with you always. Let us share a sign of that peace. The Lord be with you.
And also with you.
Lift up your hearts. Let us give thanks to the Lord our God.
It is right to give our thanks and praise.
Holy One, the beginning and the end, the giver of life, blessed are you for the birth of creation. Blessed are you in the darkness and the light. Blessed are you for the promise to your people. Blessed are you in the prophet's hopes and dreams. Blessed are you for Mary's openness to your will. Blessed are you for your Son Jesus, the Word made flesh. The night which he was betrayed, our Lord Jesus took bread, gave thanks and broke it, and gave it to his disciples, saying, "Take and eat. This is my body given for you. Do this for the remembrance of me." Again, after supper, he took the cup, gave thanks, and gave it for all to drink, saying, "This cup is a new covenant in my blood, shed for you and for all people for the forgiveness of sin. Do this for the remembrance of me." Together let us proclaim the mystery of faith. Christ has died. Christ is risen. Christ will come again. Let us pray the Lord's Prayer. Our Father in heaven, hallowed be your name. Your kingdom come, your will be done, on earth as in heaven. Give us today our daily bread. Forgive us our sins, as we forgive those who sin against us. Save us from time of trial, and deliver us from evil. For the kingdom, the power, and the glory are yours, now and forever. Amen. Come and taste the joy of God. All are welcome.
Do you? Listen to your children praying. Lord, send your spirit in this place. Lord, listen to your children praying. Send us love, send us power. Send us
Let us pray. Liberating God, you break the bonds of injustice and let the oppressed go free. Receive these offerings in thanksgiving for all your works of merciful power, and shape us as people of your justice and freedom. You we magnify and adore through Jesus our Savior. God, who faithfully brings forth justice and breaks the bonds of the oppressor's rod, bless, strengthen, and uphold you today and always. Follow the way of Jesus.
Thanks be to God.
One, two, three, four.